President Mahama launches implementation committee for SDGs.
Parties in Kumasi Old Tafo conflict make
and Uganda's president attends first election debate. Hello, good evening. You're live on your All News Channel GBC24 and GTV. This is News Hour. My name is Akwene Avo Ajaja.
I'm Gifty Eji.
Let's look at the stories now in detail. President John Mahama has launched the implementation committee for the Sustainable Development Goals.
They are charged with ensuring that the country's development agenda is in consonance with the sustainable development goals of ending poverty, fighting inequalities, and tackling climate change by 2030.
The event was to commemorate President Mahama's appointment as the co-chairman of the Sustainable Development Goals in Accra, a report by Sarah Fori.
These are the United Nations Global Goals
for Sustainable Development.
Let's get to work. Let's make it happen.
The Sustainable Development Goals, made up of 17 goals and 169 targets, are described as ambitious. This is because it requires trillions of dollars and transformational action from all UN member states. These reasons informed the decision of the United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon to appoint a group of 16 eminent persons from across the globe, jointly chaired by Norway's Prime Minister Erna Solberg and Ghana's President John Mahama. These advocates are to engage civil society, the academia, lawmakers, and the private sector to develop new ideas to promote the implementation of the SDGs. The UN Resident Coordinator, Christine Evans-Clark, said the SDGs provide a strong foundation for nations to develop and locally own the agenda, hence that of African Union's Agenda 63.
It is a plan to meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. It is one unified agenda for social, economic, and environmental development, and it is universal, applying equally to least developed, middle income, and most developed countries. As the Secretary General has said, meeting this ambitious set of agendas means building societies founded on human rights, where fear, distrust, and marginalization are supplanted by pluralism, participation, and respect for differences.
According to Dr. Nimoy Thompson, Ghana's 40-year development plan, which becomes operational in 2018, has also been aligned to the SDGs in the areas of an equitable, united, and healthy society with opportunities for all, building an inclusive and resilient economy that creates full employment and decent work, as well as a safe, well-planned, and sustainable community while protecting the natural environment. Norwegian Ambassador Hetz Hesberg affirmed the willingness of her Prime Minister, Ms. Erna Solberg, to work efficiently with co-chair President Mahama. She called for a collective response from the world leaders to end the phenomena of inequality, poverty, and conflict.
Addressing poverty, inequality, conflict, forced migration, and global warming is not something that can wait. These are highly complex global challenges that affect us all, no matter where we live or how we make a living. Simply establishing goals does not lift people out of poverty or safeguard our environment. Goals must be accompanied by coherent strategies, policies, and investments at national level. This will require improving tax revenues, halting illicit financial flows, eliminating tax havens, and combating corruption.
Executive Director of the UNFPA, Professor Babatunde Oshotime, said the fund will support the sustainable national agenda with expertise.
The biggest asset Africa has, which is sitting there and is not happening, are the curious minds, the young people of Africa. We need to invest in them. We need to ensure that they are skilled to develop Africa and the world. We are the United Nations. We're a small fry there. But what we bring is significant. We bring expertise, bring thinking. And we'll do that to support you in Ghana. We'll also do that to support you in New.
Both minority and majority leaders from Parliament promised to exercise oversight responsibility to demand accountability from government whilst amending the standing orders to ensure implementation of the SDGs. President John Mahama said Ghana will always make its space available to the UN for a prosperous world.
I wish to pledge and to assure my countrymen that I will work with the same focus and dedication that I have devoted to serving my country over the last 20 years. I'm proud to be chairing this group with Prime Minister Solberg, and it will not be the first time that both of us have been involved in global advocacy on an issue. I wish to assure that we'll continue to make ourselves available to the UN in the pursuit of its mandate of creating a safe, peaceful, and prosperous world.
President Mahama subsequently declared the SDGs Implementation Committee duly launched. Meanwhile, at the end of the 7th African Conference on Sexual Health and Rights, African First Ladies resolved to ensure that Africa's youth population does not die needless and preventable deaths. Sarah Fori, GBC24, Accra.
Africa stands to rake in $500 billion in GDP when its leaders commit to developing the capacity of the youth at an interministerial roundtable meeting hosted by the National Development Planning Commission, UNFPA's Executive Director, Professor Babatunde Oshotime, said it is high time the youth are empowered to become assets that drive the socio-economic levers to attain the Sustainable Development Goals.
African countries have often depended on the exports of primary resources such as oil and minerals for development at the expense of building the capacity of its human resource. Although young people constitute the largest population of Africa, they are mostly graduates without skills, unemployed, and often left to their fate. Most times, they are unable to access credit facilities, quality healthcare, and education. Participants at the ministerial roundtable with the executive director of the United Nations Populations Fund, Professor Babatunde Oshotime, and officials from the National Development Planning Commission were worried about issues concerning the rights and dignity of the youth. Although Africa is fraught with an aging agricultural population, the youth are not motivated to engage in agriculture, irrespective of the prospects. Therefore, it behoves on African leaders to set their priorities right and mobilize the resources as well as build on its human resource in a conducive environment. He says when the youth are skilled and provided with decent work, economies will realize their demographic dividends.
The banks have to open their vaults. We can't have this a system where people can't get access to resources. You have to have access to resources, and those resources must speak to public-private partnerships. If you are going to develop the infrastructure of this continent, it's not going to come from public sector. If you are going to develop the kinds of ICT infrastructure we're looking for, it's not going to happen. The power deficit in this continent will not be developed by public sector money. Taxation must also come into this. We don't tax ourselves. People don't pay tax. People run away from tax. The people who are rich are the ones who don't pay any tax.
Professor Oshotime implored African leaders to be long-term visionaries, transparent and accountable to the youth in order not to lose their trust. Chairman of the National Planning Development Commission, Professor Kwesi Botre, said before the aspirations of infrastructural and human resource development take place, it is necessary for effective planning.
We can't just wait and just like muddle through the processes of investment, you know, policy making and so on. We must plan. We must plan our infrastructure, our education system, as population is expanding inordinately. We face a very critical problem with youth unemployment. It's frustrating. Hordes and masses of youth are roaming the streets, some very well trained. You have graduate unemployment, they even have an association.
Experts insisted on intra-Africa trade, domestic financing of projects, continuity in governance with credible elections to ensure a stable macroeconomic environment. Serofori, GBC24, Accra.
Let's move to the Ashanti region now. The tension that was hanging over Old Tafo in Kumasi after violence erupted last Wednesday is gradually giving way to peace. A visit to the palace of the chief of Old Tafo in Kumasi, Nana Jingfenpong, by the national chief imam, Sheikh Osman Nuhu Shaributu, showed that both parties in the conflict have chosen the path of peace and are ready to put the past behind them.
The national chief imam, Sheikh Osman Shaributu, was accompanied by Muslim leaders including the MP for Asmasi in Kumasi, Alhaji Mohammed Muntakar Mubarak, and the Ashanti Regional Chief Imam, Sheikh Mumin Harun, the General Officer of Mandan Central Command, the Ghana Armed Forces, Brigadier General Joseph Okon, members of the Ashanti Regional Security Council, led by its chairman, Mr. Peter Nefi Mesa, who's also the outgoing regional minister, joined the chief imam to visit the chief of Old Tafo, Nana Ajenfrimpon, and his elders. The meeting was held behind closed doors. GBC24 guarded from some officials at the palace that Nana Ajenfrimpon said he had best no ill feelings towards the members of the Muslim and Sunni community and will live with them in peace. It was also guarded that Sheikh Osman Shaributu used the occasion to apologize to Nana Ajenfrimpon for the behavior of some members of the Zongo community and appealed to him to forgive them. Briefing the media later, Sheikh Osman Shaributu asked the Zongo youth to allow cool heads to prevail regardless of the circumstance, saying that frustrations and temptations are bound to come their way. They should, however, always try to control their emotions and remain at peace with everyone. From the Tafo palace, the national chief imam and his entourage proceeded to the Old Tafo Central Mosque to lead the prayers. Last Wednesday, a riot broke out between the youth of Old Tafo and those in the Zongo community. This led to the loss of one life. Over 50 people were injured, whilst several properties worth thousands of Ghana cedis were destroyed. The Ashanti Regional Chairman of the Peace Council, Professor Seth Opuni Esiama, said the cause of the violence was due to a misunderstanding over a piece of land at the Tafo Cemetery and should not be linked to religious, sectarian or chieftaincy sentiments. The MP for Asawase, Alhaji Mohammed Muntakar Mubarak, Professor Seth Opuni Siama, took turns to advise the youth against taking the law into their hands and also appealed for the release
of the 40 youth who have been arrested in connection with the violence. On his part, the chairman of the Ashanti Regional Security Council, RECSIC, Mr. Peter Anifimensa, promised that the 40 people arrested will be released soon, but he warned that anyone caught to foment trouble will be dealt with according to the law.
Then the Akani said,
meanwhile, the Ashanti RECSIC has reviewed the curfew hours from the initial 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. now to 8 p.m. to 4 a.m. after a review of the security situation in the Tafo Township.
Hello again, it's the Watch the News Hour on GBC24. To other stories, report from the Volta Region Health Directorate shows that teenage pregnancy is increasing at an alarming rate. In 2014, out of the 100 women who went to hospital to receive antenatal care, about 14 of them were below 19 years of age, whilst in 2015, the number jumped to 15. Also, about 300 children between the ages of 10 to 14 got pregnant last year.
The Health Performance Review is an annual event designed to afford managers and heads of health facilities to evaluate their work in the year under review. According to the Volta Regional Health Directorate, the performance of the sector in 2015 was mixed. The year saw the directorate focusing on building strong relationship between community health nurses and community midwives. This resulted in positive strides in nutrition and immunization coverage in the region. The Volta Regional Health Director of the Ghana Health Service, Dr. Joseph Nwete, said teenage pregnancy is one of the major challenges facing the region. According to figures from the directorate, adolescents of less than 14 years constituted 14.5% of antenatal care attendance in 2014. The situation increased to 15.1% last year, while a total of 301 girls of school-going age between the ages of 10 and 14 years also got pregnant last year.
I want to remind all men that it is against the law to have sex or carnally know any girl child below the age of 16.
The program manager of the Ghana AIDS Control Program of the Ghana Health Service, Stephen Intiedu, commended the region for the strides made despite challenges. He urged the directorate to ensure improved staff-patients relationship. In a related development, the Rotary Club of Hull, with support from the Rotary Club of Essen-Beldeni in Germany and the Lions Club, has presented a brand new vehicle to the Margaret Magath Hospital at Kpando in the Volta region. The presentation of the $28,000 vehicle is expected to take healthcare delivery to the doorsteps of the people in and around Kpando. presenting the keys of the vehicle. The president of the Rotary Club of Ho, Madame Susan Kujo, was hopeful that it will go a long way to make life better for the people in the area. The club also presented an amount of €2,750 to the management of the hospital. An eye specialist at the hospital, Dr. David Kopitz, thanked the club for the gesture and said that it would be used for the intended purpose to bring relief to the sick.
The water shortage in the Nsawam township is affecting various aspects of the lives of the people, but children of school-going age seem to be the hardest hit by the water crisis. Now, instead of reporting to school at 8 a.m., most of them do so after 10 a.m. because they have to go and look for water for their household.
Alex Dochi, a 33-year-old resident of Asante Kra, a suburb of Nsawam, travels over 1.5 kilometers every day in search of borehole water for his daily activities. According to him, the journey in search of potable water is a nightmare due to the daily stress of getting borehole water. He emphasized that the long queues at the borehole makes the search of water more frustrating.
This is where I fetch water, and because of the long queues, I have to get here early in order to get some water.
The night of Alex Dochi is not different from Hajia Adiza Mustafa, who is also a resident of Adoejiri.
We really suffer to get water. We are appealing to the authorities to come to our aid.
Adiza explains that she has lived in the area for more than 30 years, but has never experienced such a crisis. Currently, she depends solely on the Dinsu River for her daily water supply, despite the dangers and risk involved in crossing the road and fetching water directly from the river.
We are tired of fetching water all the time. We call on the government to come to our aid.
These are some of the views by residents in the area.
People are suffering, especially school children. They are always late for school.
Due to the scarcity of water, the demand is high, thereby creating long queues. If there is any problem, we are pleading with the authorities to find a lasting solution to it.
And someone was hit by an acute water crisis early this year as a result of the severe Harmattan season. The development, which expects blame on the El Nino phenomenon, has led to the drying up of the Dinsu River, the main source of water supply for the people in the community. Managers of Ghana Water Company point to illegal mining activities at the source of the Dinsu as one of causes of the drying up of the river. The Dinsu stretches from Etiwa through some parts of the Achim area to Nsawam. Unfortunately, the area has become the hub for illegal mining activities, thus affecting the quality of the water upstream. Chainsaw operators are also rife, thus exposing the river to harsh weather conditions. The Ghana Water Company says the polluted water is very expensive to treat, hence it called on Ghanaians to pay more. Residents of Nsawam Adoejiri are paying more for water, but they cannot even get it and have to walk long distances to get the commodity. Medical practitioner at the Nsawam Government Hospital, Dr. Lache, emphasized that there could be an outbreak of waterborne diseases like cholera, dysentery and other infections if the water crisis continues.
They need water for their daily activities. They need water for proper hand washing after visiting the private. They need water to do away with their waste products. So it's very important that if the water shortage is not tackled properly, it can bring medical problems like dysentery or cholera, as you rightly said.
He therefore appealed to the Ghana Water Company to dialogue with the people and find a lasting solution to the water crisis to prevent any outbreak. The problem facing the people of Nsawoma Duejiri might just be a tip of the iceberg, especially at a time that climate change is flexing its muscles in Europe, Asia, and Africa. Experts say the way out is for Ghana to adopt climate change resilient strategies, including tree planting and putting an end to mining activities along riverbanks.
The wife of Vice President Mrs. Matilda Emisa Arthur says non-governmental organizations working in the interest of children must pool their efforts to get parents involved in their integration effort. This is to ensure that parents are responsible for their own children. Mrs. Emisa Arthur was interacting with officials of the Pemela Bridge Water Project in Accra when they called on her. She donated educational materials to support the advocacy project, which is to secure a future for underprivileged girls and children, especially Kayayis.
The call on Mrs. Matilda Emisa Arthur by the officials and beneficiaries of the Pamela Bridge Water Project was to solicit resources to support a campaign project aimed at providing a future, welfare and social security to disadvantaged girls and children, especially headquarters, popularly known as Kayaye. This would be done through training, education, advocacy, protection, and research. The project runs Kayaye Distance Adoption to School campaign, where corporate bodies, philanthropists, and individuals are encouraged to adopt, sponsor, and resettle Kayaye to school while they stay with their original families. It also helps to prevent all forms of abuse, such as human trafficking of Kayaye from the northern part of Ghana to the south, and exploitation of children. The project director, Mr. Yaya Alassan, said the Kayaye phenomenon is a national concern and should be tackled as such.
We urge all Ghanaians, you know, to visit the center and make their support to the facility.
The wife of the vice president, Mrs. Matilda Emisa Arthur, noted that various NGOs that deals with the welfare of children should collaborate and also get parents and guardians involved in their activities so that they can effectively pool resources for maximum achievement.
Find a system right now and let the system be working so that at the time when the Pamela Bridgewater project doesn't have the money, there's some mechanism to take them. For example, one of the ways you can go around is also to letting the parents be also accountable. They may not be able to fully pay school fees, but at least if every term a parent puts in 10 Ghana cedis, it is something. Apart from helping, that also puts a responsibility on the parents, and the parents also becomes responsible.
The officials and the children commended Mrs. Emisa Arthur for always looking out for the good and advancement of the less privileged younger generation. They appealed to the government and other benevolent individuals and organizations to help curb the Kayaye phenomenon and also help children in general. Theodora Medeto, GBC 24, Accra.
St. Paul Technical School, SPAT, is gradually losing its shine after producing middle-level manpower to support Ghana's development in the past 60 years. Infrastructure at the school's campus at Kukrentumi in the East Achim Municipality of the Eastern Region is seriously begging for assistance. This came to light after Unibank donated an 18 kVA generator to the school.
St. Paul Technical School in Kukrantumi Achim, popularly known as PATS, was established in 1957 by SVD of the Catholic Church. It was headed by the American and German missionaries for a while, and its third principal was Ghanaian. There are many products of the school serving as technicians and engineers in key sectors including Gridco, VRA, Anglo Gold Ashanti, and ECG. The school runs courses such as auto mechanic, building engineering, mechanical engineering and metalworks. 60% of work is practical and 40% theory. The technical school was solely for boys until about 6 years ago when it started enrolling girls into the school. This was through a Danida-sponsored program that sought to give girls the chance to be trained in technical education. So far, three of the girls have graduated, with one working with AngloGold Ashanti. The principal of the school, Mr. Benjamin Ijabin, told GBC24 some of their challenges.
We have a six-unit classroom block, which the project has taught, and so if we can get this six-unit classroom block online, then it will reduce the classroom allocation challenges we are facing currently. The dining hall, they have to go in shifts. One group, Form 3s, will go and eat. When they finish before Form 2 and 3, Form 1 will also go and take their meals.
The Koforidua branch manager of Unibank, Mr. Isaac Omani Kranting, while handing over the generator set to the school, explained the reason for the gesture.
As part of Unibank's contribution towards the promotion of good and quality education in Ghana, and especially in Achim Kuprentumi, we from Unibank see this as a great opportunity to lend a helping hand to St. Paul Technical School in order to discharge their duties with much efficiency and effectiveness by providing them with a generator set.
The board chairman of SPATS, Mr. Andrew Nyakunwedu, was grateful that a locally owned bank is supporting the school.
We take a breather at this point.
Back to the news. Let's talk business now. The Commissioner General of the Ghana Revenue Authority, GRA, Mr. George Blankson, has urged staff of the authority to ensure that values and principles that guided their superiors in revenue mobilization are upheld. He said this will help them in the future when they take up management positions. Mr. Blankson said this at a farewell ceremony for the Assistant Commissioner of Customs, Excise and Preventive Service, Alhaji Mohammed Nasiruddin in Accra.
After serving for 34 years as a revenue collector, he has to bow out from active service. This is the story of the former Assistant Commissioner Preventive Alhaji Mohammed Nasiruddin. He joined the then Customs and Excise Department in 1983, and duty took him to several custom offices across the country, including Kumasi, Bolgatanga, Kofoji, and other places. The Commissioner of Customs Division, Mr. John Vani, lauded former Assistant Commissioner for his meritorious service to the nation.
Alhaji's exploits are boundless and suggest how we must all work to attain the highest values in professionalism, bringing to bear all the training, skills and experiences to fulfillment of performance standards.
The Commissioner General of the Ghana Revenue Authority, Mr. George Blankson, said steps are being taken to ensure that revenue targets set for the year is achieved. The outgoing Assistant Commissioner, Preventive Alhaji Nasiruddin, said rising to the level he is did not come cheap, but by diligence and perseverance.
Yeah, this day has finally arrived. I have waited for the day for 60 good years. What can I say than to say thank you very much, Almighty Allah, who has made all this possible.
The staff of SEVS presented gifts to the outgoing Assistant Commissioner.
The Bank of Ghana has placed a deposit protection bill before Parliament. When passed into law, it will build a safety net for small savers. Depositors will therefore have a fallback position in the event of any institutional failure. The bill does not, however, ensure full recovery of deposits, but seeks to provide safety net for depositors. The head of banking supervision at the Bank of Ghana, Mr. Raymond Amanfo, announced this at the opening of the Kumasi branch of Ideal Finance, a non-bank financial institution.
Ideal Finance started in a rented shop at Naku House at Jowlin, Accra in 2010 with three people and an initial capital of 27,000 Ghana cedis. After 6 months of operations, the company moved to the Kingsway building in Accra Central. The staff strength increased from 3 to 10. And in 2012, a key management staff was brought on board to facilitate the rapid growth of the entity. The year 2013 saw further expansion with the opening of the Tema branch. The official launch of its Kumasi branch, which happens to be the fourth branch and the first of Ideal Finance outside the Accra Tema enclave, is meant to serve the northern sector of the country. That Chempemhene of Kumasi, Oheneba Eduse Epoku, formerly outdoored the Kumasi branch. The vision of Ideal Finance is to be a standard of excellence in financial services with a speciality in the provision of tailored financial solutions to businesses that are largely focused on SMEs, organizations and individuals. That Chempemhene of Kumasi, Oheneba Eduse Epoku, used the occasion to appeal to the management of the company to extend its tentacles to the other municipalities in the region. The president of the Association of Rural Banks, Dr. Philip Yao Amache, urged management of Ideal Finance to be mindful of the increased levels of risk that characterizes branch expansions and institute measures to mitigate its impact on depositors and shareholders. The head of banking supervision of the Bank of Ghana, Mr. Raymond Amanfo, emphasized the need for banks and non-bank financial institutions to pay particular attention to the financial needs of their clientele base.
The market players tend to play among the same customer base. It is therefore important for institutions such as Ideal Finance to think outside the box in order to become the preferred choice in this competitive marketplace.
In an interview with GBC24, the group chief executive of Ideal Finance Holdings, Dr. Niko Tejani, enumerated product and services that the Kumasi branch of Ideal Finance has for its clientele.
Ideal Finance is basically a finance house. We give medium, long-term loans, we give school loans, we give check loans. We also have investment.
Welcome to My Journey. My Journey today delves into the current misunderstanding between farmers living and working on their farm plains and the activities of nomadic Fulani herdsmen, which have led to deadly confrontations with casualties on both sides.
Farm plains forms part of the Farm Plains Basin, which includes districts like Edra Sechi Dumasi, Sechre West, Sechre East, Asante Achim North, Kwao South and Fantiakwa. The plains for a very long time has remained a strategic food source in the country's quest towards food security. The topography of the area and the fertility of the over 800,000 hectare make it favorable for the cultivation of vegetables and other foodstuffs like cassava, yam and plantain. Part of the plains is also good for the planting of cash crops like cocoa and rubber. With the Volta, Afram and Obosum rivers traversing the plains, thousands of farmers and their families are able to farm all year round by applying rudimentary irrigation methods. The largely savanna nature of the vegetation has for some four centuries attracted nomadic Fulani herdsmen from neighboring countries like Niger, Mali and Burkina Faso with their cattle to graze on the plains.
For the past decade, however, competition for grazing land for cattle, as against the rising demand for farmland for crops, has led to deadly confrontations between the indigenous farmers and the nomadic Fulanis. In the process, innocent farmers have been shot, maimed, raped, or even killed. In the affected villages, some of the locals showed our news team some gunshot wounds sustained from the Fulani attacks. This 67-year-old woman lost her 18-year-old son on Christmas Eve 2014. GBC24 visited some affected farms. Our cameras captured some farm produce which have been destroyed by the cattle.
We used to harvest all sorts of vegetables, but now if we come here, the Fulanis will kill us.
I planted 3 acres of cassava, but the cattle have destroyed all. We only visit our farms when we know the herdsmen and their cattle will not be there.
I've been using this rubber to harvest rainwater for some time now, but whenever the Fulanis get here, they offer the water to their animals and destroy the rubber.
The cattle like fresh grass, so they set fire into our farm within a short time. When the grass starts growing, they bring the cattle to graze on it.
I just planted corn, but I am afraid the cattle will soon destroy it.
We also found cow dung and footprints indicating that some cattle have been to the affected farms. These are some spent cartridges our team found in the bush, an apparent indication that some armed skirmishes have been happening here. In the course of capturing the 32-year-old Kwame, a tomato farmer reported to us that his farm was being destroyed by a herd of cattle. When we got to the scene, we could not film the destruction at close range because we feared being fired upon. Just as always, anytime the clashes in the plains assume high levels, interim measures are quickly adopted to calm the situation. Not too long ago, the government deployed personnel from the Ghana Armed Forces to the plains to contain a similar occurrence under the codename Operation Cowleg.
The Operation Cowleg team really saved us.
Currently, there's a standby force to quell the violence that has erupted earlier this year in some parts of the country. From the plains, our team attended a meeting of the national executives of the Fulanis in the country. Each of the 10 regions was represented by one headman, where they described the current relationship between them and farmers on their farm plains as simply unhealthy.
This thing goes back to about 6 to 7 years now when this thing started. Like I show you in our record here, we have so many casualties. People have been killed in the bush, and some even recently last year, here at, is it Ashama or no, after the Ashama, where this seven member family of the Fulani and his wife, Adedome, we went there, Fulani and his family, making seven. And the children, they were all burned to ashes. We went there and forced the door open. They were all in smelly.
Among for no, Tambia, Musrea, Omufatu, Omukon Abua, Omukonimpa, Tambia, Omufra soldier for Susu Omaba, Omusi soldier for Oberboy, soldier for Susu Aba, Omukunanche, Tambia.
Bebre Waho, Omunenche, no, aye Ghanaians, aye indigenous, no, Nenchi, aye Omushasu, and my Ghanaians. Nienti ayasem no ay very dicey. Always no ya kan negative side of Fulani, ya kan positive side. There is no tribe wagana ha. Obeti ma shen nentri su, cattle su, ji Fulani. Fulani fons wana provide nam magana. And uko akati market, uko Germany, uko Ashama, uko Japan, Kumasi. Nentri ayotonyi na ay nam ay provide my Ghanaians from the Fulanis. A positive side.
The national president tells me that There are about 40,000 Fulanis currently in Ghana. Of this number, half are into livestock rearing. According to him, ever since the deadly clashes began, nearly 100 people have been killed on both sides. This booklet contains pictures of some murdered Fulanis. The national chairman of the Fulanis, Honorable Chief Alhaji Idrisu Muhammad Bingel, claims he was a member of the government panel that developed a national document on livestock for Ghana some years ago. He tells me his position then, and as it is now, is for interested chiefs as well as the government to consider rezoning their farm plains by demarcating specific areas for cattle rearing.
In that book, we said that the government should see to it. He brings in the town and country planning. They'll go to the chiefs. Those who are willing to give lands to these Fulani people for cattle rearing, they should try to zone the area. You see, if they zone the area, there's clear demarcation. I am the chief of this area. All this land belongs to me. You have come. You are a cattle farmer. I have zoned my area myself. This right part is this where crop farmers should go and do their crop farming. You cattle farmers go to the left side and do your cattle farming. This is the only way that this problem can be resolved.
Somehow, there appears to be some consensus on how to deal with the problem on the ground. Both parties to the conflict seem to think that the time has come for those interested in cattle rearing to go into big-scale ranches instead of leaving the animals to roam about. Our team has learnt that due to this conflict, some pupils are unable to attend school, thus suffering from a collateral damage they do not deserve. Again, some health personnel have also threatened to abandon their health post for fear of attacks. At this health facility, the health workers here showed me pictures of the damage caused by some Fulani herdsmen who invaded their health facilities a few weeks ago.
In the international segment, Ugandan President Yoweri Museveni is taking part in his first televised debate ahead of elections on Thursday. Mr. Museveni snubbed Uganda's first pre-election debate last month, saying such events were for school children. The Ugandan leader, 71, is seeking to extend his 30-year rule by winning a fifth term in government. The focus of the second debate is foreign policy and national security, considered to be Mr. Museveni's strongest points. The first debate focused on domestic issues like health and education. 8 presidential candidates are contesting Thursday's polls. Ugandans will vote in parliamentary and local elections on the same day. Somalia's Islamist militant group Al-Shabaab says it carried out a bomb attack on a plane that blew a huge hole in its fuselage earlier this month. In an emailed statement, Al-Shabaab said the attack was revenge for Western intelligence operations in Somalia. The Dalo Airlines Airbus 321 with 47 passengers on board made an emergency landing in the capital Mogadishu after the explosion shortly after takeoff. One person said to be the bomber was reportedly blown out of the plane. And that's it in the international segment. Coming up shortly is sports.
And our sports. Dansuman Hurricanes this afternoon beat defending champions Cosmos Buffaloes to progress to the final of the 2015-2016 Ghana Rugby Club Championship. They won by 13-7.
Last year's rugby champions Cosmos Buffaloes RFC clashed with Dansuman Hurricanes RFC. The encounter was one of the semi-final matches on the day. Cosmos in the black and green jersey were looking to defend their title after finishing the round robin league on the second place. The lads from Dansuman, one-time winners of the league, were also hoping to record their first victory over Cosmos for more than 3 seasons. Both sides were cautious in their approach and tactically disciplined.
In the dying embers of the first half, Dansoman Hurricanes winger Kelvin Amankwa broke the deadlock by successfully converting a penalty to end the first half 3-0. Back from the break, the tempo of the game increased. The lads from Dansoman had the better of the play. Kelvin Amankwa increased their tally by converting another penalty. The Hurricanes had the self-belief they can win as Amankwa ran through the defense of the Buffaloes to score a try. He then converted to send the tally to 13-0. Captain of Buffaloes, Michael Akwilson, scored a try and a conversion to end the encounter by 13-7. Here are some reactions.
To us, it's not a different or a very biggest disappointment because we've endured such defeats before. And any team that doesn't endure such a defeat is not a team. You lose to win. You lose to learn. So when you lose, you take it in good faith.
History will repeat itself again. We were first to win this cup, and now we'll win again. We will show them that we are not dead, we are still alive.
The president of the Ghana Rugby Football Union, Mr. Herbert Mensah, said he was impressed with the quality and level of rugby displayed.
I think the semi-finals today are very important for Ghana rugby. You've seen a level of enthusiasm that has not been there before. The two losers, or the winner of the second one and the loser of the first one, I think could have even won. I think that when you look at the quality of the game, I think in the case of IDAS, if they'd had greater self-belief, they continue to play it as simple as they did in the first 10-15 minutes, they would have beaten Conquerors. I think so. And I think that today marks the first time in my memory that Cosmos have been beaten, and it shows a hunger from the other side. You know, we are a far long way away from having rugby the way we want it. But looking at the enthusiasm, the support that you've seen for the game today, I think it's absolutely fantastic.
Dansoman Hurricanes will face Conquerors in the final set for next Saturday at the Accra Sports Stadium.
In the arts and entertainment segment, the beginnings of the up-and-coming artist is usually a tough nut to crack. However, with hard work and determination, one can sail through. This is the experience of a Ghanaian hip-hop artist known as Prime Staff. Earlier, he was on our showbiz segment, GBC24.
Hardcore rap in tree.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Hip-hop, hardcore rap in tree.
Mupi ni tree and a pop. Thick and a soft. Fish and a pop. I will give you all. Mubu me weak, me a strong. Feet and a young. Thick and a tall. What them see me, I saw. Me will block all chip of the black. Man do the talk, yes a sip, you the sock. Muni na more size.
So no matter how difficult the journey is going to be, no matter how tough it is,
12 years and more. I've never given up.
Who inspires you the most?
Last two.
Okay.
Nkasai, Okonfo Kwade, Lord Kenya.
Okay. Mm-hmm. In the meantime, let's talk your new video. What's the title of the new video?
Kajiko.
Thank you so much for joining us for News Hour. We'll be back at 10:30 with This Week.